Well, I'm so glad you stumbled upon me here. Thank you for coming to join me on Living Figuratively. Welcome to Living Figuratively with your host, Judy Takács. Last week, I told you all about the Love Athena triptych, which was, it's basically the epic triptych I told you about. It's sort of the culmination of chips with balls that bridges the gap between the Goddess Project and my Chips with Balls project, and shows you how women working together can and should be the goal that we all shoot for. This week, I'm going to tell you all about how the painting came to be. So, with each major painting that I do, or even minor paintings that I do, I'm going to put away this thing. It all starts with, a concept. Once I have the concept, then I start to gather my people, and I schedule them for a photo shoot. Right now, I am standing in the spot where I do my photo shoot. I have a big boom light here that I love because it gives me that nice contrasty overhead light. I set up my camera on the tripod with the clicker so that I don't, you know, hold the camera and shake it while I'm taking the picture, and that way I can, you know, get some nice non-fuzzy photos. And I hang my backdrop behind me. Right now I have it all set with a purple backdrop because I actually have a model coming tomorrow for a photo shoot for a Goddess Project painting. More on that later. When I had people pose for the Love Athena triptych, I had to have them holding shields. Instead of picking balls, they were picking shields. And before I even started the whole process, I went on Amazon and I found as many shields as I could. These are all Halloween costume shields. They're just, you know, kind of made out of plastic. They're kind of cheap. And I just sent for them all because I figured I wanted people to be able to choose from them. I wanted them to all have different shields. I didn't want it to be the same kind of thing. So I sent for all these shields, and then I spray painted them all silver so that they would have a uniform look. When I staged my my photo shoots with the shields, basically I had everybody pose. I had them pick their shield, and then I had them pose at all different angles, just in case I wanted to use that angle for the Love Athena triptych. So I'd have them go like this, I'd have them go like this, I'd have them go like this, I'd have, you know, all different kinds of things. Also with emphasis on hands, because I didn't want their hands to all be hidden, because then you've just got a bunch of portraits with a big shield in front of them. So I tried to have them have the hands in sort of different interesting positions. So now, let's head over to the actual Love Athena triptych, and I'll show you how it all came together. I'm going to put that down there. All right, so here we are, once again, in front of the Love Athena triptych. When I first compose a painting of this size, which I've actually never done one of this size and scope with this many people in it, that's why I call this one my Magnum Opus so far. You know, hopefully I have other Magnum-y opuses ahead of me, but right now this is sort of my Magnum Opus so far because it's got 8 people on it, you know, biggest thing I've ever done. One of my things that I was thinking when I was lining up the different people, because each one had a photo shoot at a different time, so I didn't have like everybody come together. So I had to do the photo shoots individually just because of logistics. One of the things I was thinking about is the undulating interest of heights, and, you know, a little bit forward, a little bit back. Since I cast myself as Athena, who was kind of the big protector instead of being the evil queen bee from the concept from last week, I made myself bigger. you know, because I'm about front, and also to sort of create a little bit of that superhero lined up superheroes concept. I'm sure you guys have all seen movie posters where superheroes are all lined up like that. So I was kind of thinking of that, but also didn't want it to be, you know, completely a cliche like that. But I know it does have, you know, notes of that. For those of you who love superheroes, maybe this is reminiscent of that. With the Love Athena triptych, there were certain people that I had chosen specifically because they had posed for chicks before, you know, like sometimes 6 years ago. And they had also gone through some major transitions in their life. Like, some of them had gone through hell, some of them had gone through hell and back, some of them are still going through it. So that was kind of my direction, is like having overcome a lot since the chicks with balls pose. Now, many of the women who posed, I have about 50 women who posed for chicks with balls, many of them qualified for that absolutely, because a lot more than just the few that I'm showing here have gone through hell and back and have gone through some major transitions. But logistically, things kind of have to fall in place and work certain ways. So basically, I couldn't start the painting until I had the photo reference for all the people that I was going to do. Because I didn't want to get into a situation where there was like one person missing, and then I was planning on tucking her in, you know, being on the side here, and then at her photo shoot, another pose emerges as the best one, and then now suddenly I'm sticking the wrong pose into the wrong place. So the painting had to come forward together. And during the painting time, there was one person in particular who I really did want to be part of it. She was actually the inspiration for the whole Chicks with Balls project in the very, very, very beginning. And if you've read my first Chicks with Balls book, you may be able to figure out who it is. And her life definitely over the past decade has taken some, you know, major hell and back adventure. And she ended up not saying no to this one, but she is going to pose for me for the Goddess project, which I'm thrilled about. And I'm collecting the props for that right now. One of the things that I'm looking for, and I'm gonna send this out to, you know, Facebook land, one of the things that I'm looking for is a lyre. And I don't mean a politician lyre, I mean a musical instrument lyre, like this. And that's not a lute, it's a lyre, L-Y-R-E. So I'm looking for an interesting lyre to have her pose with. But anyway, so sometimes nothing makes sense in a painting until suddenly everything makes sense. And that happened with the serendipitous discovery of this beautiful mother and child here. Who she did not pose for chicks originally. She and her daughter are new posing for the first time. And the way that I first discovered them or found them was actually at the grocery store. I was shopping at the grocery store and I saw this beautiful mother and child at the fish counter. And when I saw them, I just thought to myself, I will be regretting it the rest of my life if I don't approach them and at least ask them if they would want to pose for me. You know, I have to at least ask. They might say no, they might say, you know, don't want any part of it, sorry lady, but I have to at least ask. And the way that I do that when I approach, you know, basically strangers, and a lot of times it's in the grocery store, but when I approach strangers about posing for me, it's basically what I say is, hello, my name is Judy Takács. I'm an artist from the area, and I just love, like in their case, I said, I just love this whole look. I love the image of the two of you together. And I paint people, and I would like to see if you might be interested in having me pay you as a model. I don't say, you know, a commission or anything like that, because then I'm just trying to sell them something. I'm actually trying to hire them for a job, which makes it a little, you know, maybe a little bit more enticing. That's what I said, and I give them my business card, and say, you know, if you want to hear more about it, send me an email. So I put the ball into their court, so it's maybe a little bit less intimidating. If I don't hear from them, then I know that they've looked at my website and have decided not to do it, or they didn't take me seriously and didn't, you just threw away the business card. But if they do contact me, then I'm really, really psyched, because then I kind of go into the longer process of, this is what a posing session entails, this is how much I pay you, these are the rules with the posing session. And I basically, I spell out the concept that they're going to be posing for, because I feel like, A, it makes them more informed about the process and who the character is that they are going to be playing, because in many situations it's a character, like a mythological character. And it also, I also want to make sure that they're okay with, you know, the concepts that I'm doing. Because I'm questioning things that people believe. I'm questioning mythology. I'm questioning religion. I'm questioning things. And I want to make sure that they're okay with the way that I paint my paintings. So fortunately, this beautiful mother and child did contact me back, and they said, yeah, they were interested in posing. So I was Johnny on the spot. You know, we booked a date. I had them come over, and they were so natural and cozy with each other. I can't imagine a better posing session. I mean, they really just, you know, they have this bond that it's very, very, very obvious. And the look of the both of them with their bald heads was amazing and compelling. To this day, I still don't know the full story behind it, because I don't force people to tell me everything. I was hoping it might just kind of come out, but we never got around to it. So I don't know the full story behind it, but I have seen them since, and they seem happy and healthy. So that's a good thing. That's actually a wonderful thing. It's not just, you know, I don't want to trivialize it. That's wonderful. So the complexity that it offered me, though, was the bald youthful heads. And that, so when I have a visual challenge on a painting, a lot of times I will go looking for inspiration in another painting that I admire. I happened upon this beautiful piece by Will St. John, who is a contemporary artist. And he's got this gorgeous bald head. The printout, I'm sure, does it no justice. I've never seen the original painting. This is just a printout on my printer. But I pin this up on my inspiration board when I'm, you know, painting, just so that I sort of get the feel of it. And since it was such a new subject, what I actually did was I painted a couple studies, which I usually don't do that, but because they were both unusual and because it was a child, and children for me are harder to paint. I'd rather paint old people than children. And she was at a, you know, an interesting angle. I thought I would paint some, you know, studies, which I was glad I did, because when I put the painting together, they really did kind of flow together nicely. Now, that is exactly what I wish that I had done with Pam. Okay, so for Pam, I had to go to Nebraska for the photo shoot, and, you know, it was a terrific weekend in Nebraska. I can see how it, you know, it grows on you. We had a really fun time in Omaha. For Pam, I've known her for 21 years. I had painted her before for her reversible chicks portrait, which I thought came out, you know, pretty darn well, and I really liked it. And so I was fairly confident going into, you know, just diving right in without doing any preliminary studies. One of the things that I discovered, though, when I was painting Pam, she had this expression that was a really tough one to get. Basically, it was kind of this knowing twinkle in your eye, you know, sort of a little bit of wisdom, a little bit of mom knows best, a little bit of sadness maybe, a little bit of wondering about the future, but a little bit of humor and confidence at the same time. There were many things at play in her expression. So when I went looking for inspiration to try to capture her expression, in 500 years of figurative, you know, realistic figurative art, I could not find one single piece of inspiration that that really captured her expression. Also, 500 years of figurative art, there are not a lot of good paintings of African American women or men. They're just not, you know, not present there. So I went looking to contemporary art. One of my favorites, who I've talked about before, Karen Offutt, had a gorgeous painting of a lean, beautiful African-American woman. So, you know, I was able to get a little bit of inspiration from this one, even though her expression is more of a serious one. And then the other one that I found was Lee Coley White has this wonderful book that is available on Amazon and, you know, I'm sure in art stores, where actually the model on the cover was a really nice inspiration. And in fact, it was so nice, I decided to do a master copy from it. And if you remember what a master copy is, it's basically where you find a painting that you want to learn from and you copy it to the best of your abilities and try to soak in everything that the painter has done so that you can learn it too, learn, you know, go through their steps of their process. And that's what I did with this painting, which I was very, very happy with how it came out. So I was able to do Pam's expression. I still don't think I've totally and completely captured it. So there may come a day where I go back into it, because I've been known to go back into paintings and you know, rework things. Hopefully it will rework for the better, because it's a big painting, so like there's a lot of investment in it. One of the other aspects of complexity with the Love Athena triptych was the shields. Because all the shields were plastic spray-painted shields, I wanted them to look like old silver. I wanted them to look like old, you know, classy old masters, Rembrandt-y old silver. In fact, here's a Rembrandt old silver shield that kind of started my whole thinking process about the shields with stuff on them. This particular shield, it actually had a Medusa on it, just like Sharon's shield has a Medusa on it, and Sadie's shield has the Blind Eyes of Justice on it. One of the shields that I had to recreate right here, and it was a particularly poignant story, is Shannon's shield. Shannon, if you remember from last week, she's the one that was originally posed for Chicks during the middle of her gender transition time. When I went to revisit her, I knew she had to be part of the project because she had gone through some of the most major changes that somebody can go through. So when I went back to revisit her, she told me that one of the things during the depths of her struggled with bulimia, dysmorphia, anxiety, and, you know, just all the issues that she went through leading up to the gender transition. She really liked the Bionicles. Now, those of you who have kids that grew up in the 90s, maybe you remember the Bionicles. They're these little characters, they're Legos that you have to assemble. They come in a little tube and you have to assemble them. And she really liked the soft and comforting click of the Lego pieces from the Bionicles being, you know, popping together, because they've got these little round joints and everything. And I can see how that would be just kind of satisfying, like it's in a place and you're clicking it into place and things are working and they're being put together. You know, it's a little bit of a symbolic sound. So I decided to put a Bionicle on her shield. And the way that I did it was I went digging through my kids' stuff and found more Bionicles, grabbed one of their shields, one of their faces, glued it onto a Christmas ball, and spray painted the whole thing silver. So this was what I used as my model for Shannon's Bionicle shield. It was much smaller, but you know, it's the same general concept, and you get the highlights on it, you put the light on it in the right way. And you know, you can simulate it. Now, one of the other things that I did to help me with all the old silver was I was inspired by the work of
Sadie Valeri, whom I have also mentioned before. She does these amazing old silver vessels. I'm going to call them vessels because she's got ones of different shapes. And they just have this gorgeous self-restraint to them, where the darks are in the right places, the mediums are in the right places. She doesn't rush to the highlights. I'm a big rusher to the highlights because, you know, I'm like, I want it to be poppy and highlighty. And so looking at her work helps me exercise the self-restraint to really make something look like old silver. And that's pretty much, I used principles from her work and from looking at her work to do the various shields that I had to essentially make up. Like Pam's, I made up the circles and I had to, you know, make them 3D. For mine, I have all kinds of things reflected in here. I actually have, you know, references to, Karen Offutt's painting that inspired me is reflected in there. And then the tiny one by Lee Coley White is reflected in there. The only person who had a real silver shield was Laura Lee. Laura Lee is actually a jewelry artist. And for her shield, I used it's actually a tiny piece that she brought. It's probably only about 3 inches tall, if that. It's like pretty tiny. But it had the round ball on it, and she brought it because she was coming for her Chicks with Balls posing session. I took some photos of it thinking this might make a really cool shield. She held a different shield, but I thought, you know, I'm gonna give her special shield. So this is actually a real piece of silver with real silver highlights on it. But I did still have to use Sadie's, you know, thinking and inspiration to sort of exercise the self-restraint. And what I did was I actually put Sadie's self-portrait that's reflected in this silver vessel, I put it into this silver vessel. So there's a little nod to Sadie Valeri. And Sadie Valeri has a website, Sadie Valeri Atelier, where there are all kinds of wonderful videos you can download and instructional videos. They're just primo. You know, they're really, really very, very worthwhile. She tells you, you know, a lot of great how-to stuff. And then over here for these, for Serpy and Sharon's shields, I had to take stone images, because I got a stone image for this one, and make it look shiny and silvery. And, you know, Sadie's work also helped me with that. And, oh, duh. The other aspect of the shiny shields, because that was definitely a major struggle on this painting, the other aspect of the shiny shields that I always had to think about was the reflection of your hands, the hands holding it, into the shield. That really adds to the realism of it. And you kind of then have to figure out where is that reflection going to be. That I was able to, with the fake shields, you know, get the where the reflection was going to be, but not exactly what that reflection looked like. So one of the things that super helped me, and actually I've been doing that for, you know, 10 years, because my very original, my first Chicks with Balls portrait, where I finally grew a pair, I had to use the same thing, where it was my reflecting ball and then reflecting my hand in the reflecting ball. So the piece that helped me in the very beginning was this piece, also by Lee Coley White. I had acquired this piece at the Portrait Society of America conference, probably in like 2011, where it's the 6x9 auction. And she basically, I think this is her own hand, she did her own hand reflected in a mirror. And to me, looking at this piece gives you the secrets of how to depict a reflection. So she has this dark core right under the reflection. There's a little bit of a dark core at the touch points. And then the reflection is much cooler. And that just makes it sit right back. It sits right back so that the real thing is much warmer. So, you know, it's really just good to look at things like this. And so that you can use those guiding principles for your own painting. And I did that right here with my reflection. And one of the things, this is another thing that I might have to go back in and fix that I didn't even realize I did, I reflected my hand, but I didn't reflect the paintbrush. So I may fix that or I may not. I'm gonna have to see because I, you know, the paintbrush didn't really reflect in real life. I think I added it after the fact. Anyway, so I'm gonna close today's episode because I'm already, you know, going over time by telling you about the necklace. This necklace, which I included in the painting two times, I'm wearing it here and then I'm wearing it in real life. And I'm also wearing it on my very far portrait at the end. This necklace is by jewelry artist Kim Mattee, who I talk about all the time. And the story behind it is that very close to Mother's Day, about 8 years ago, I found a charm bracelet in a antique shop. And this charm bracelet basically had a woman's whole life on it. Her name was Betty. She married Jim on October 18th, 1969. She loved President Kennedy. She worked for the phone company. She went to the 1965 World's Fair. She had a Sweet 16 party. She sang in the church choir. She had her whole life on this charm bracelet. It was a bracelet at the time. And it somehow ended up in an antique shop and nobody in her family wanted it. So I thought, you know what? I want it. And now you know that I already have a charm bracelet because you saw from my, you know, shaking Marsha in the card house episode. So I didn't need another charm bracelet, but I brought it to Kim Mattee to make into a charm necklace. And she went into a sort of a inspired frenzy, essentially. She told me about the process. Kim posed for Chicks with Balls. And when I painted her with Chicks with Balls, she was also telling me about another inspired frenzy, which is why she ended up with four arms instead of two. And she went into, when she was making this necklace, she went into this inspired frenzy where she just stayed up all night and kept adding things and moving things and came up with this gorgeous, gorgeous piece that is a huge conversation piece. And it also pays tribute to a mystery woman who we don't even know who she is. It's kind of like a necklace of the unknown woman tribute. And Kim called it Sweet 16. And I thought it was perfectly, made perfect sense for me to wear it in the Love Athena triptych, where I'm paying tribute to women and basically, you know, showing that the world is better when groups of wise women come together and take care of each other and also take care of the people that, you know, we are each protecting. And that is what Chicks with Balls, Love Athena, and the Goddess Project are all about. Now, thank you very much for joining me this week. I really, really appreciate it. And remember, during these corona times, all art sales, I will be paid forward, 50% of the profits will be paid forward into the struggling art community. Right now, I have on my website, Love Athena Gicle that I just put up there. And that one also, 50% of the profits will be paid forward into the art community. The Love Athena triptych right now is not for sale. Just like, hang up on it. The Love Athena triptych is not for sale right now because it's got places to go. And yeah, just hang up on them. Anyway, also join me next week for Living Figuratively, where I'm going to be talking about the gift you give yourself is the gift of giving art to members of your family. It's a win-win situation. So join me then, same bat time, same bat channel, 6 p.m. Thursday nights. Y'all come back now, you hear?